Wow. Who needs a takeaway? What do you do yourself?
Nothing's bad, nothing's whack. It's all solid, and some of it's actually pretty good. Really good. All right. It's really good.
I've never tasted anything better.
The umami flavor is peak in the cup.
Oh, that's delicious. It's just so warm and comforting. And
okay, let's give this a go.
Wow.
Wow. Okay, that's me enjoying some fried rice and dumplings. There's something magical about the flavor that makes it quite appeasing to most of the world. And by this title, you already know we're going to talk about the famous ingredient, MSG. So let's dive in to see what this is all about.
Oh, wow. Wow. That was some good food. Look, growing up, fried rice has been my favorite thing to eat, irrespective of which restaurant it's from. Although my mom would make good fried rice at home, there was something that was always missing. It just didn't kick. My mom would use the best ingredients, and a lot of these restaurants would sometimes not even have much going on with them in terms of ingredients. And it took me a few years to find out that this missing ingredient was MSG, or as I knew it in my childhood as Ajinomoto. And MSG has been a big taboo growing up, and this coming from a family that did not have the healthiest lifestyle. I can guarantee you that. We'd have every unhealthy ingredient you can think of, but MSG was off limits. And this MSG for the longest time has been feared across the world. And restaurants would put boards out saying no MSG to try and brand themselves as healthy. There's a lot to understand here of what made this the most famous and infamous ingredient together. Now let's understand where this mystery ingredient comes from. It's 1907 and there's a professor by the name of Kikune Ikeda. Kikune Ikeda. How do you pronounce it?
Kikune Ikeda.
Kikune Ikeda. Anyways, so he's a professor at a university in Tokyo. He and his family are having dinner. He notices there's something good different about the stock his wife made. It's different than what he's known or what he makes. If you read about it, there are variations on the story. But anyways, the important point is he wants to know what's this flavor. His wife tells him it's kombu, a dried kelp. So she would add it while boiling the water and remove it after. This gets the professor curious and wondering what's causing this. So he gets to work. And a year later, in 1908, the professor manages to isolate the crystals and finds that this substance in question was glutamate, which was nothing new at the time. It's one of the most common amino acids found in food and the human body. It naturally occurred in milk, meat, fish, mushrooms, and other vegetables. It is one of the most essential amino acids for humans as protein building blocks and neurotransmitter production. One of the most abundant amino acids in breast milk. This could be one of the key reasons why it's recommended that kids get breast milk at an early age of development. The professor in one of his accounts mentions his plight for the people of Japan and with the goal of making something affordable that can add flavor to their food. He goes on to say, having always regretted the poor diet of our nation, I had long contemplated how it might be remedied, but had found no good idea until I read this article. It then occurred to me that manufacturing a good, inexpensive seasoning to make bland, nutritious food tasty might be a way to accomplish my objective. Mind you, this is 1908, and Japan has quite the wealth gap or wage income concentration. Anyways, back to Professor Ikeda. His observing was that this sensation was different than the four characteristics of taste we had defined so far. Salty, sweet, bitter, and sour. And he named this new characteristic of taste, umami. But it wasn't until 2000 that umami taste receptors were discovered. By 1909, he figured out how to commercialize this by combining it with sodium, giving it the name monosodium glutamate. Mono would stand for one, so in literal molecular nomenclature, it was one molecule of sodium and glutamate. Ajinomoto Inc. was formed as a subsidiary under Suzuki Pharmaceuticals and allowed Professor Ikeda to sell the seasoning he invented and patented. And by 1920 and 1930, it takes off in US, China, and many other countries. So what makes MSG unhealthy? It's 1968, a professor by the name of Dr. Ho Man Kwok who notices something unusual whenever he ate at Chinese restaurants. He decides after a few instances to share his experience with the New England Journal of Medicine. In his letter titled Chinese Restaurant Syndrome, he would narrate, "For several years since I have been in the country, I've experienced a strange syndrome whenever I have eaten out in a Chinese restaurant." In this, he is describing his symptoms as numbness in the back of the neck, gradually radiating to both arms and the back, general weakness and palpitation. And he ends by requesting the medical community to do further research in the area. And when this letter gets published, it goes all over. Multiple research papers follow. So a few key events happen with this publishing. Research papers follow covering on the Chinese restaurant syndrome. reporting symptoms like abdominal discomfort, flushing of the face, and another paper coming out talking about burning sensation. As the paper would describe it, a burning sensation usually beginning over the chest and spreading subsequently to the neck, shoulders, forearms, the abdomen, and occasionally the thighs. This varied in intensity from a mild sunburn to severe scorching sensation. Now, public opinion is outraged, and especially if we had to take a look at the US. Let's try to grasp the prevailing sentiment at that time. It was post-World War, an era marked by several references to xenophobia. But even more pronounced was a specific unsettling resentment aimed at Asians. So you have both of this completely approaching MSG like an open target. The negative sentiment and fear towards MSG just skyrocketed. To a point, we call it by its chemical name and not Ajinomoto, what it was called originally. I mean, do we call salt bisodium chloride or NaCl? People feared it, like it was cancer coming towards them. But something's not right. MSG has grown to other regions. Why out of the way is America the only one reporting on such symptoms? Japanese people have been having it for decades. Why hasn't there been similar reports on symptoms faced by people over there? And by the 1920s, it had also entered the Chinese market and eventually boomed. So something's up. By the 1980s, researchers began to look into this a little more. What was found was that a lot of the studies done were done on the basis of unrealistic testing conditions. Like, one of the famous studies was based on the reaction of mice after being directly injected with MSG. Second, study groups were established under unrealistic conditions. Third, a lot of the studies that were done under the presumption that there was a Chinese restaurant syndrome. As this study by this professor highlights, the majority have been elicited by questionnaire, solicited by the media, or provoked in laboratory studies. What's even more interesting is that certain studies went on to claim other effects like asthma, psychiatric reactions, behavioral changes. And this professor further puts it really nicely. The only attitude that can be taken with regard to these anecdotes is one of naive realism, which assumes that they are vertical and must be taken at face value until proven otherwise. And this is the one that's most surprising. Dr. Ho Man Kwok didn't exist. Wait, what? Research Foundation, Silver Spring, Maryland. Wait, this can't be true. I mean, if he was fake, then the medical institute would have retracted it or put a claim against it. Unless National Biomedical Research Foundation, Silver Spring, Maryland. It doesn't exist. So the story goes that there were these two friends, Howard Steele and Bill Hansen, who would go to a Chinese restaurant once a week where they would eat and drink so much that they would feel sick. So one fine day after their meal, Hansen decided that he would send a letter to NAGM and keep a few things obvious. Like his name, Robert Ho Man Kwok, sounding close to human crock. Even the name of the institute he used was made up. And to his surprise, this gets published. He tried to get it removed, but it was too late. He even called the editor of the journal, who he knew since his childhood, to get it removed, but he just cut the phone on him. So this changes the whole story. But of course, this doesn't clear it all out, right? There are things we need to be careful or wary of. The food industry loved when they found something that could tap into your senses directly. Let's say you have a favorite dish, like dumplings or momos. You've probably noticed that they have a special taste you can't get enough of. And a big part of that is because of MSG. Your brain has made this connection, a neural pathway that links the unique taste of those dumplings with the presence of MSG. It could be the same with fried rice. Irrespective of if you're having Chinese, Japanese, Indian, or Indonesian fried rice, around all the different ingredients, you will notice a commonality between all the flavors. And that's the umami from the MSG. Now you have these chips, boastful of flavors. So there are two important things happening here. One, if you're noticing, you'll sense a familiarity with the flavor because your brain already has that link between MSG and that delightful taste from your dumplings. It's like your brain saying, hey, this is familiar and satisfying. And the glutamate your body has been having for decades is sensing association with other foods that you're used to having, like milk, meat, and fish. Again, this isn't the only thing that goes into making snacks and chips addictive. There's a lot of food science that goes behind it. Truth be told, most of the MSG we consume comes from the food we're advised not to have, like fried chicken, chips, and all sorts of other nonsense. But if we want to address the problem, we need to have better context. Like, if you're having fried chicken every day, then it's not MSG that's the problem. And there's a lot of reason why you should avoid certain foods, irrespective of whether they contain MSG or not. And there's a lot of reason why certain foods we're advised not to have. Like, for fried rice, it's not MSG that's the unhealthy ingredient. And irrespective, I'll probably continue to have fried rice every now and then. Like, how can you say no to fried rice? But maybe our biases don't have to skew towards something because it's convenient. Like, if we want the world to make healthier choices, it comes down to informing them rather than making choices for them. It's important to think what got us here. Even decades later, 40% of Americans say they avoid MSG. Like, how often do you have people at restaurant asking what type of oil they use versus if the food contains MSG? And mostly at Asian restaurants. And the funny thing is, people are fine when it's hidden as other ingredients. And to think that this all happened with a fake letter, a fake name, and a fake institution. Despite all the research coming out, clearing all the allegations, the thing that surprises me is still how the biases set in. The boards saying no MSG are out, and they're here to stay for a while. But there is a bit of hope. People are clearing opinions on MSG.
Many people say MSG bad for your body. Why you feel MSG so weak? So weak.
The next time you order some Chinese takeout and someone starts talking about getting a headache or something else, you'll be able to tell them. It's not the wonton soup and it's not the MSG. It's probably just in your head.
MSG got branded as dangerous. Even though there wasn't evidence for that, it created this rumor that has sort of stuck with all of us today.
So I'd definitely be interested to see where people stand on this 10 years later.